Isaac. I'm a registered dietitian here at the University of Vermont Medical Center with Nutrition Services, and I'm here today to talk about menu planning and putting a system into place where, well, you really create a bunch of small steps, a bunch of small things all together to give you the path that will guide you to healthy eating. The system that you put into place will help guide you through the many, many food choices you make on a daily basis, not just for your main meals, but many of the meals and snacks that you have over the course of the day. And hopefully also with focusing perhaps on your main meals, create a less stressful, more relaxed dinner environment for when you do get home from work after a busy day. You'll have the answers for that question, what's for dinner, already ready, set up for you earlier in the week. And as a bonus, having a meal plan or creating this system can help you save money with smarter shopping, as well as reducing food waste, making sure that you are using up your more perishable items perhaps for earlier or first, and also creating plans for leftovers. It can take a bit of time when you first set up your meal system or your plans, but really you'll have a payoff at the end with saving money, eating healthier, and hopefully less stress in the long run. So one of the first steps is to see what you've got already. Check out your cupboards, your freezer, your refrigerator. See what you have on hand to use up. And one of the things that I do actually to focus on making sure I use up my perishable items, I actually post a list of my perishables on the front of the refrigerator. This helps me actually cross off the things that will go a little soft earlier in the week than perhaps later in the week. So yesterday I just picked up some cucumbers and zucchinis, and those will go first, as well as, and then perhaps my carrots and beets that have a little bit more staying power will be used towards the end of the week. So take a look at what you have and what you can use up, and that will be a place to start. One of the next steps is to take a look at your schedule for the week. Take into account your work schedule, your kids' schedule, maybe evenings out that you have planned with friends. So you can really take a look at the days where you are going to be short on time to create your meals and days where you'll have a bit more time to create a little bit more complex meals. So you can lay out some different ideas. One tool that might be helpful, especially when you first get started, is something like a worksheet. This one I downloaded from choosemyplate.gov, which is a website that has a lot of tools around making healthy food selections. It does cover breakfast, lunch, and dinner, as well as snacks. And this, especially during the school year, you might have a different type of schedule and meal schedule than if you have kids in school than you would in the summer. So in the summer, you may also have to account for more breakfast and lunch, maybe a little bit different snack schedule than you would when your kids are off at school. So to lay out your meals will also help help you later creating a grocery list, and we'll get into that in a minute. One of the next steps is actually, and as part of creating your schedule, is thinking about your recipes. And you may have your list of tried and true recipes, some family favorites that you have, and creating the core recipes that you use that may be quick and easy is helpful to have during the course for those nights where you don't have a lot of time. You may want to think about creating theme nights for your family that help them also with meal selections as well. So some choices might be the Taco Tuesday idea, which doesn't necessarily commit you to tacos every Tuesday, but you may use that as a launching off point for other Latin foods, things like enchiladas or quesadillas, maybe some other areas of Latin America that you want to explore as well. I may be showing my age, but when I was a kid, we had Italian every Wednesday. I think it may have predated the Wednesday's Prince Spaghetti Night commercials that were popular when I was a kid, but that was something we always knew, that Wednesday night was going to be Italian night at our house. And then some other options too for looking for new recipes. There's lots of great recipe books, and you may already have a full shelf of those at home. So finding some different recipes to earmark or try can be helpful. There are a lot of great recipe apps that are out there. One that I actually use a lot is called Yumly, and what that allows you to do is actually search by ingredients. So if you open your fridge or have on your list that you need to use up some ricotta cheese, maybe a little bit of broccoli and some chicken, you can pop those ingredients into your search engine in Yumly, and it will pull up a slew of recipes. I actually just did that a little while ago and it pulled up 140 recipes. So you have a lot of options to choose from there with the recipe apps. So from there, once you kind of have that outline of your meals for the course of the week, you can create your shopping list. And this you can sometimes, you can just do a standard running list. Actually, I keep another little tool I keep at home is a little notebook that I keep on my kitchen shelf or my kitchen counter. And I use an item up. It goes, especially with spices or kind of more the staples, it goes on the list so that as I create my more specific meal plan, I can add the incidentals for the week. But as I'm running out of items, I do keep a running list of those things. And then based on the recipes that I find for the week, then I'll add to that list of the different items. And then you can do the low-tech way like this, just a little notebook or an envelope or something along those lines. But again, this is another great way that you can use technology. There are a number of apps that are out there that you can share grocery lists or keep a grocery list for your family. There's one called Needed, which allows you to share. It's one grocery list, but there can be different users. So depending on who's in your family and who's in your household, if you have someone at home, perhaps over the summer, who just finished off the gallon of milk, hopefully they can go onto the list and add it to the list and kind of keep that a live list so that the next person who goes to the grocery store knows that that was just used up and needs to be picked up again. There's also another app called Cozy, I think I'm pronouncing that correctly, but C-O-Z-I, that actually includes not only the to-do list or grocery list, but it also is a shared family calendar. So you can put in the events for the week, including games and rehearsals, meetings, and you can actually in there also put in the recipes that you want to make for that day. So depending on who gets home first, perhaps they can start the meal prep. And it also can create, a shared grocery list for those whoever gets to the grocery store first can pull it up and get the grocery shopping done. Another idea is, again, using up leftovers. And these can be planned leftovers. You can make a double batch of a pasta sauce or a double batch of a stew, like a chili or a beef stew or something along those lines, or even just pre-prep some of the components of a different meal. This time of the year when it's summertime, you may grill when you have a little bit more time and throw some extra chicken breasts on the grill. So that way you would have a component for a meal later in the week that you can just pull the things together. You can throw the previously grilled chicken into a salad, into quesadillas, into a pasta dish, all different types of things. But if you pre-prep some of your items earlier in the week, you can have those kind of to use up when time is short, or this time of year. Actually, I'm not sure if I said this, I meant to say this. When I look at the schedule for the week, I actually look this time of year at the weather, and I only plan my intensive cooking nights on rainy nights, and I plan for, on a beautiful day, I plan to go out for a bike ride or a hike or something along those lines. So I tend to plan for a quicker meal on those nights. So there's a lot of things that can go into thinking about the schedule. And it may change over the course of the year, but just if you find what works for your family, that will work, that will make this your whole system that you're setting up be a little bit more successful in the long run. Another suggestion is to really share this whole meal plan with the key players in the family. To share the responsibility for the grocery shopping, for some of the meal prep, and also selecting some of the items that go into the meal plan will make this a much more sustainable system in the long run. Again, you can use apps, you can use a whiteboard on the refrigerator where you may jot down your items for the week, or a shareable Google Doc or something like that where different users can get in. You may want to make perhaps the menu part only editable by certain people, so that it's viewable perhaps by some of the younger family members, but not editable, so you don't end up with pizza every night. But again, taking into account everybody's wants and needs in the family, hopefully will create that long-term sustainable plan. So meal planning really, or creating the system, does take some time up front. It can take a little bit of, it can take some of your Saturday or Sunday morning to lay out, to maybe take a look at what's on sale at the grocery store, to have that be a key component of your week's meals. And it may take a little bit of time to get into the habit of creating these menus and lists, but the payoff at the end with healthier eating, saving money, less stress, will be its own reward. Hi, Gina.
Hi, Andy. Thanks so much for being with us today.
Hi,
my name is Gina Britton. I'm with the University of Vermont Medical Center, and we have a great couple of questions here from our audience that we'd like to ask Kathy and put her on the spot.
Awesome.
So first question came in was, you know, this is all great, sounds wonderful, but I am super busy. I have no idea even how to start this process. Mm-hmm. What would you recommend as a first start for somebody who is going to try their first week of meal planning, perhaps for the next week?
I would actually even suggest starting with just 1 or 2 days of the week to create a meal or, you know, their system. Maybe pick the one night, you know, the Taco Tuesday, or another night where they know what those items are going to be. Cook up a little of the extra staple type food so they would have something, you know, easier to pull into other meals. It can be, you know, again, starting any new system or habit, it's really hard to start everything at once. So as the theme is, you know, one small thing, start with just one step.
So take one day of the week, perhaps, and make that your day that you planned ahead.
Exactly.
And have shopped ahead for, and then can actually prepare your meal ahead
exactly.
of time.
Exactly. Yeah.
I can imagine that would save a lot of time when someone's really busy.
Exactly.
Another question that came in was, how can I get my kids involved? How can I bring kids into this? I'm a super busy parent. You know, how do I get my kids involved to help me out with meal planning?
Right. That's a great question. I think it can depend on the age of the child, certainly. And it can depend perhaps on their wants and needs as well. You know, there's some kids at certain ages that all they would want to eat is macaroni and cheese,
yep.
given the choice, or perhaps pizza, given the choice that, you know, of that meal. But I think they also respond to the inclusion into the plan, and sometimes it helps to have them, you know, when you remind them of the plan, that this is the plan that they had agreed to mm-hmm. earlier on. So if it's, and also having them choose some of their favorite food items to
yeah.
include in the meal plan, hopefully we'll get along, you know, help them move along. I think the older kids certainly can start, and when they start learning how to food prep, if they know the meal plan for the week and they're home earlier one day, they could even start being the sous chef, doing some of the actual prep for the meal too, and that, you know, learn and practice some of those cooking skills.
And maybe if they're adventurous enough, maybe they could actually pick
exactly.
a meal to serve to the family.
Exactly.
It may be, you know, something that's not so exciting. Maybe
mm-hmm.
it's flatbread pizzas at home, or maybe it's a salad or some
right.
kind of soup.
Right.
But that would be a great way to get them
yeah.
involved, I think.
Right. There was a family actually that I heard of that even when the kids were super small, even I think they were kindergarten age, they each had a night of the week that they would mm-hmm. be responsible for prepping the meals. And so the one child, when it was their night, they all had peanut butter and jelly for that night of the week. But then as they grew and aged and, you know, started reading recipes, starting to be more adventurous, their meals did, you know, grow with them as they aged too. But they also then went out into the world with this great toolbox of cooking skills.
Sure.
And knowing how to do it themselves too when they got to their own homes.
Yeah. So one final question we had was, how about freezing meals? I mean, is that okay? Can you cook ahead of time and then freeze some, and then how do you know what to do with it afterwards? I mean, how does freezing work?
So freezing can be great in not only just the whole meals, but also components, sub-ingredients. So for one example, some foods that take a long time to cook, but you can cook in bulk, like beans, dried beans, if you're starting from scratch. What I often do is cook up an entire pound or 2 pounds of beans at once in the slow cooker, and then freeze them in a cup and a half containers.
Single servings?
Yeah, which mm-hmm. is approximate a can of beans.
Oh.
And so then when I have a recipe that calls for a can of beans, I just pull that out of the freezer. Same thing with wild rice. Wild rice takes almost an hour to cook.
Mm-hmm.
So if I wanted to do a recipe that calls for 2 cups of wild rice, I'll quadruple it sometimes, depending on how, you know, or triple it, and then freeze the extra wild rice in about a 1.5 to 2 cup container, and then that's already pre-prepped for the next time I want to make the recipe.
Right.
Freezing whole meals can work well, and you can, if it's a meal that you would serve to your whole family again, you could serve it in or freeze it in a larger container. But the other option is if it's something that you would bring to lunches or bring, you know, just pull one serving out at a time, then breaking it up into a smaller container so that you can just pull one serving out at a time.
Right.
It's almost like you're creating your own convenience meals for the next to have a storage of.
Makes it easier than having to call for delivery
exactly.
or run out for burgers because
exactly.
you already can shop in your own freezer.
Exactly.
Very cool.
Yep.
Very cool. Well, thank you so much
for
this.
You're welcome.
Very helpful. If any of you have any questions that you'd like to share with us, any comments, we'll welcome them on our Facebook page. And we can certainly also post some links to the information that Kathy shared with us here today. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time.